cameras, spy cameras in the sweet box.
And personality seen a most person from the bar, Mr. Shri Subodh Markandeya. So now 82 years old. The today very interesting topic, that is Bhulabhai, Desai and INA trials, their place in Indian legal legacy. So sir, that is our normal practice, you know sir, we will introduce ourselves one by one. After yeah. that you can. Even Netaji Subhas Chandra Bose, great admirer, he written several books on Netaji also. Last time Friday group itself, he has presented a book. And a lottery, I think one of our member got in that lottery, that book is dedicated to him. That's, I mean, tax law also, he has written very nice book. So this is a small introduction. So myself, Sheshgir Rao, sir, this is, you can introduce.
I'm Naveen.
I'm Rakesh Kumar Yadav.
Supriyanshu Meshri.
Anil Kumar.
Shekhar Prijha.
Nipika Bapna.
Sir, I'm VVS Rao.
Naresh Kumar.
I'm P.K. Malik.
Bharat.
Bharat Kumar.
Yeah, then. No, you are. Nachapan, sir.
I'm P.K. Malik. My grandfather was a college mate of Netaji Subhas Chandra Bose.
Oh, great.
Grandfather was?
He was a college mate of Netaji Subhas Chandra
Bose. Wow. Okay.
In fact, we have handwritten letter from Netaji at our house. We have.
Do you know his birthday is on the 23rd?
मधुरिमा डाटी
पट्टाद्र
विजयश्री पटनायक
Vidyanandam.
Yourself.
Amit Pratap Singh.
Yeah, please now. Sir, now we are starting again. Yes.
Preservation is a great problem in India. So this INA trial, the defense address of Bhulabhai Desai was by some quirk of luck preserved by AICC, which published it. So that's how it is available.
Right.
I'm very glad that Mr. Sheshagiri Rao has now started this process of preservation of our addresses. Yeah. So this is in two parts. One is about the person who, that is Bhulabhai Desai, and the other is about the cause which he fought. So, defense address delivered by Mr. Bhulabhai Desai, the doyen of Bombay Bar, at the trial of Major General Shahnawaz and Colonels G.S. Dhillo and P.K. Saigal of the Indian National Army by the court-martial held in the Red Fort, was published by INA Defense Committee in January 1946. A bound copy of the defense address is lying in my library. Sir. And it's my fervent...
Why?
It's my fervent wish that it is republished as a tribute to incomparable advocacy of Mr. Bhulabhai Desai. So now about the man. Bhulabhai Desai was born at Valsar, a town in South Gujarat, on October 13, 1877. His father, Jivanji Desai, was a government leader. After early education in Nawabai School at Valsar in South Gujarat, he went to Bombay and matriculated in 1895 from Bharada High School, standing first in the school. He graduated from the famous Elphinstone School of Bombay with history and English literature, winning the Wordsworth Prize. After obtaining MA in English from the Bombay University, he became a professor of English and history at the Gujarat College, Ahmedabad, and was very popular amongst his students. He simultaneously studied law while being the professor of English, and after obtaining LLB degree, he passed the advocate's original site, because in these presidency high courts there was original site and there was appellate site. So he passed this examination on the original side and was enrolled as an advocate and started practice on the original side of Bombay High Court. Original side, they used to hold trials, criminal and civil. So those lawyers became very adept in cross-examination and all these things. By dint of his intellect and hard work, by 1913, he became one of the front-ranking lawyers and was acclaimed by the bench and bar alike. Amongst his distinguished juniors was Hiralal Kania, the first Chief Justice of India, Motilal Setavad, the first Attorney General of India, and K.M. Munshi, who earned name not only as a lawyer but as the most prolific author of modern Gujarati literature, and also founder of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. There's a very interesting episode about Munshi, which I read. In his reminiscences, Munshi relates a very interesting anecdote about the human side of Mr. Desai. Munshi received court summons for having depicted a Jain hermit in adverse light, so that the Jain community of Bombay brought criminal action against Munshi. So with fear writ large on his face, he approached his senior, Mr. Bhulabhai Desai. So Bhulabhai Desai got very angry and he said, "Aren't there enough briefs in my chamber that you have to write novels? So now that I have to defend you, please tell me what all you have written." So Munshi said that under pseudonym Ghanshyam, I have written a novel called Verni Vasulat. So that relieved Mr. Desai very much and he said, "I'll definitely defend you." "Sir, why?" So he said, "I'm in love with the heroine of Verni Vasulat." The Desai joined Indian National Congress and was elected to the Central Assembly. Parliament was called Predecessor of Parliament was called Central Assembly. He distinguished himself as the leader of Congress Legislative Party. The war budget in 1945 was defeated due to efforts of Mr. Desai, due to strategy which he had. Now the second part is about the cause. Due to tight censorship imposed by the British government in India from 1939 and the Draconian Defence of India Act and the rules, very few people knew that Subhash Chandra Bose had escaped from the British dragnet, and on reaching Berlin, he organized Free India Center on the scale of a legation of an independent country, and it had set up Azad Hind Radio, which was broadcasting in 12 languages. He also founded the Indian Legion from the British prisoners of war captured in Libya by the legendary German Marshal Rommel, who was called Desert Fox. But sensing that his mission to liberate India by a combination of diplomatic and military efforts will not materialize, he told the government, German government, that he should better be sent to Far East. Therefore, he left for Japan in a German U-boat, and after a perilous sea journey, he arrived in Southeast Asia by a Japanese submarine. He was transferred off the Madagascar coast from German U-boat into the Japanese submarine. On reaching Singapore, he galvanized 2 million strong persons of Indian origin throughout Southeast Asia. Information about the provisional government of Free India, the Indian National Army, the Free India Center of Berlin and the Indian Legion was perceived to be so dangerous that the British government in UK forbade the British Broadcasting Corporation from publishing anything about them. Listening to these broadcasts was very severely punished under Defence of India rules. On October 23, 1943, Bose formed the Provisional Government of India. This government was accorded recognition by 9 countries: Burma, China, Croatia, Germany, Italy, Japan, Manchukuo, Philippines, and Thailand. The Irish government also extended its all good wishes for the success of the campaigns of Provisional Government of Free India. The Provisional Government of Free India pledged to free India from the British yoke and to protect the life and property of the Indians in the Far East. And for this purpose, they raised a 3-division strong Indian National Army from the remnants of the Indian officers and men who were delivered by the British Army to Japan on the collapse of Singapore, and also fresh civilian persons of Indian origin recruited by the Provisional Government, and also formed a police force. The Provisional Government acquired territories including Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which President Bose named as Swaraj and Shaheed Islands, and administered them through trained Indian Azad Dal, as it was called. The Provisional Government established Azad Hind Bank, which had at the time of the close of Second World War 60 crores of rupees. It printed also for issue currency notes and postage stamps. More important than anything else, the Provisional Government promulgated the INA Act for governing, for raising, training, and for the discipline of officers and men of the Indian National Army. The INA Act proved to be very useful because of the INA Act, the application of Japanese military code to INA was obviated. The Provisional Government inspired the whole generation of leaders in Indonesia, Malaysia, Vietnam, and other countries. The Indian National Army and its ally, the Japanese Army, came knocking right up to the India's eastern cities of Imphal and Kohima. But the tide of war turned against them, forcing their withdrawal first to Rangoon and then to Singapore. With the use of atomic bombs by the United States on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Japan surrendered to the Allied forces on 15th August 1945, bringing the Second World War to an end. President Bose paid off and discharged all the officers and men of the Provisional Government and the Indian National Army, and himself flew off to seek help for India's freedom, never to return. His accredited representatives, Major General A.C. Chatterjee, was arrested in Rangoon by the advancing British forces. Major General Chatterjee's counterpart in Singapore, Major General M.Z. Khan, was arrested by Lord Louis Mountbatten. On landing at Singapore, the first act of the British forces was to dynamite the marble memorial called Shahid Smark, fondly built by Netaji on the Connaught Drive of Singapore to honor the INA heroes who had died fighting India's freedom. For decades, various governments of India dithered in getting the Shahid Smark restored, but now the government of Singapore itself has restored the Shahid Smark as part of its own national heritage. The arrested officers and men of INA and the ministers and functionaries of the Provisional Government were hastily brought to Delhi and incarcerated at detention camps without being accorded the status of prisoners of war, who they were. The end of war loosened the tight censorship which was imposed in 1939, enabling the nationalist press to publish mass of material from Southeast Asia and Europe about the exploits and activities of the Provisional Government and the Indian National Army and the Free India Center and Indian legionaries. This spread of saga impacted the general public, but more than them, the Indian jawans and officers of the British Armed Forces. Film about Provisional Government and the INA brought from Singapore was doing rounds and rounds of sympathetic audiences in New Delhi and elsewhere in India. Hindu has recorded Mahatma Gandhi's eulogy for Netaji's achievements, and I quote, "The greatest amongst these achievements was to gather together under one banner men of all religions and races and to infuse into them the spirit of solidarity and oneness to the utter exclusion of communal and parochial sentiments. It's an example that we should all emulate." So in this background, the British government decided to try three officers of INA, Major General Shahnawaz Khan, Colonel G.S. Dhillon and Colonel Prem Kumar Sehgal, and it created an outrage throughout the country. Gandhiji wrote to Viceroy Lord Wavell, "I'm never blind to the valor and patriotism of these men. India adores them. No doubt the government has overwhelming might on its side, but it would be misuse of that power if it is used in the teeth of universal Indian opposition." In the words of Jawaharlal Nehru, the trio had become the symbol of India's right for independence. It was a trial of strength between the will of Indian people and the will of those who held power in India. Even Mr. Chinna, the Muslim leader of the time, advised leniency in dealing with them. Jayaprakash Narayan, the noted socialist leader of his times, lauded Subhash Chandra Bose as a fervent patriot and justified the acceptance of military aid by him from the Axis powers for securing India's independence. Gandhiji even met Commander-in-Chief Claude Auchinleck to dissuade him from proceeding with the trial. The Viceroy turned down the plea by Gandhiji to abandon the trial. Therefore, charge sheets I think he has circulated.
Yes, circulated in the
charge sheets dated 17 September 1945 were served on the three accused under the Indian Army Act 1911. By order of 25th October 1945, the British commander of Bahadurgarh area constituted a 7-member general court martial under the presidentship of Major General A.B. Bexland. The court martial consisted of 4 British and 3 Indian officers. Sir N.P. Engineer, the Advocate General of India, was appointed as the Chief Prosecutor. Shahnawaz, Dhillo and Saigal faced the charges of waging war against King Emperor, murder and abetment. All India Congress Committee, by its resolution of 22nd September 1945, stated it would be a tragedy if these officers and men and women are punished for the offense of having labored for the freedom of India. It therefore constituted an INA Defense Committee of 17 distinguished lawyers of India, including Bhulabhai Desai, Sir Tej Bahadur Sapru, Asaf Ali, Dr. Kailashnath Kadju, Jawaharlal Nehru. 4 High Court judges, ex-High Court judges, that is Justice Tekchand, Justice Dilip Singh, Justice P.K. Das, and they also were part of the INA Defense Committee. Mr. I.D. Dua, who later became the judge of the Supreme Court, and Mr. S.N. Andle, who later on became the Chief Justice of Delhi High Court, were also part of the INA Defense Committee. Bhulabhai Desai, doyen of the Bombay Bar and leader of Congress Legislature Party in the Central Assembly, was entrusted with the task of defending the accused. On the eve of INA trial, Bhulabhai Desai was taken seriously ill and he was advised complete rest by his doctors. But disregarding medical advice, he drowned himself in INA papers. Reading them brought about a complete transformation of his perceptions about Netaji and the INA. He, without any reservation, confessed to Dilip Kumar Roy, a great musician of his time and disciple of Sri Aurobindo, I quote, "I had grown to echo what coterie in which I moved said against Bose. Finally, scales have fallen from my eyes. Netaji was a far-seeing statesman, a born realist, a strategist to his fingertips, and an idealist come seer, who was haunted by an irresistible, almost mystic call he had to answer with his freedom-hungry blood." The trial opened on the 5th of November 1945 in a makeshift court in the historic Red Fort. The prosecution placed before the court over 250 pages of oral evidence. 30 witnesses was examined on behalf of prosecution, and 150 pages of exhibits. These exhibits included proclamation of the Provisional Government of Free India. At that time, what happened that some colleagues of Mr. Bhulabhai Desai was objecting that he is doing nothing. He is allowing these documents to be placed on record. So Bhulabhai Desai counseled patience. He said, "I'll use these very documents to defend these my clients." Amongst the exhibits was the proclamation of the Provisional Government of Free India, dated 23rd August 1943, and statement made by the British, by the Japanese Premier General Tojo in the Japanese Parliament Diet regarding transfer of Andamans and Nicobars to the Provisional Government. The defense consisted of deposition of 12 witnesses, the Japanese dignitaries and top functionaries of the Provisional Government and the Indian National Army to prove the Indian National Army's aims and objects, that is liberation of India, their total independent functioning, their organization, their campaigns, etc. The facts were established by the prosecution evidence itself. Bhulabhai Desai sharply cross-examined the prosecution witnesses to demolish the prosecution case about murder. He could establish by cross-examination that the charge of murder was baseless. In fact, those persons who were allegedly murdered were actually deserters, and they were tried and found guilty by an INA court-martial and were sentenced to be shot, as all deserters are. But in fact, no death sentence was carried out. Therefore, nobody was killed, so the murder charge had to fail. Bhulabhai Desai's defense address was very spirited. He spoke for 2 hours, he spoke for two days, over 10 hours, without any notes. Published verbatim, it occupies 132 pages. He marshaled facts with great ability and built up a legal case, and that's the case. He said that as a consequence of the British surrender of Singapore and handing over of Indian men and officers to Japan, these officers and men stood released from their oath of allegiance to the British Crown, which formed the very basis of the charge of waging war against the king. He said that with the proclamation of the Provisional Government of Free India, the INA became an instrumentality of a sovereign PGFI, which had all the trappings of the state under the public international law. He further said that Provisional Government and the INA were following their goal, which any government worth its salt has to do, namely winning India's independence, and under public international law as well as under he invoked Section 79 of the Indian Penal Code. The acts of officers and men of INA were beyond the purview of the court-martial, which is a municipal court. He further argued that expression law in Section 79 includes public international law, and therefore the principles of public international law will apply, and the acts of belligerents under the public international law are beyond the purview of municipal court like court-martial. Then he further refined this argument by saying that recognition in envisaged under public international law for immunity of facts is the recognition as a belligerent and not the diplomatic recognition of the INA by the British government. Very fine point which he made. Dr. Kailashnath Karju, a leading member of the Allahabad Bar, who at different times became Union Minister for Home and Defense and also Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh and Governor of West Bengal, has ranked Bhulabhai Desai's defense address at the INA trial as a great forensic performance. I quote, "It was definitely the first argument delivered before a tribunal which endeavored to justify in point of law, both international and municipal, the right of Indian people to wage a war for their liberation from the foreign bondage." I quote historian N.G. Jog also. Jog said, "Desai's extempore address was a tour de force of great legal erudition and forensic skill. The pity of it was that it was addressed to the court-martial composed of officers, military officers, who are innocent in law, and not to judges of higher judiciary trained to understand and appreciate the subtleties and intricacies of international law. The court-martial gave its verdict on 31st December 1945, finding the accused guilty of the charges and sentencing them to transportation for life. But of course, the commander-in-chief remitted the sentences to cashiering. This was perhaps the last major case argued by Bhulabhai Desai. He fell seriously ill on 30th September 1946 and passed away on 6th May 1946. INA trials are very important for our, very important in so far as India's independence is concerned. The INA trials had electrifying effect in the elections of the Constituent Assembly held in 1946, where Indian National Congress won massive majority. Then there were mutinies to a limited scale in the Army and Royal Indian Air Force at Dehradun and Jabalpur, which were put down with very heavy hand. But there was more serious thing. Ratings aboard the Royal Indian Navy ship Narmada mutinied on 18th of February 1946, and it soon spread to almost all the ships stationed at Karachi, Bombay, Madras, Vishakhapatnam, Calcutta, and Andamans. They hauled down the Union Jack and hoisted tricolor on all the ships. Firing raged for almost a week in Bombay and Karachi. By heavy deployment of British officers and men, the mutiny was put down, but it shook the British Empire from its very foundations. I had some experience, so I'll share with you. There was a file, its title was Treatment of Boers. It started with the notings of Lieutenant General Tucker, who was General Officer Commanding Chief of Eastern Command. So first notings were his. The file then went to Field Marshal Claude Auchinleck, who was then the Commander-in-Chief. Then the file went to War and Home members of the Viceroy's Executive Council. And ultimately, after notings by all these gentlemen, it went to Field Marshal Archibald Wavell, who was the Viceroy. All of them attributed the freedom that was about to dawn in India to the sea change which was brought about by the attitude of the officers and men of the British Indian Army, Navy and Air Force, and the police and civilian staff, who no longer were excited about their loyalty to the crown, but they said that nearer home, it's the motherland to which we owe our loyalty. So they have all attributed this to the efforts made by Subhash Chandra Bose and his provisional government and INA. And when Clement Attlee also said that yes, sea change came only because we thought that we can no longer govern India, because the loyalty of all the people under for whom we, on the basis of which we were running our empire in India, is no longer guaranteed. So in such a situation, a great transformation which came is, in my view, makes the INA trial our very glorious legal legacy.
Now we can have a questions, answers. Anybody, you want to ask Madhurima? Okay. Please, anybody can raise and all. You want?
No.
Sir, no questions? Seems to
no
be.
No questions.
It's a very like knowledgeable, like yeah. People not having any idea about yeah. This area was like...
You want to say something? You can please write.
Like, 1 minute. Sir, can you view this? Vidyananda, please. No.
Sir, there is no doubts at all, sir. There is something wrong.
No.
They are fully enriched with this thing.
This is a true account of the history, and how can we sometimes...
Patabi, you have any doubt or anything you want to express something like? I mean, overall, I mean, so overwhelmed.
It's
sir, thank you very much, sir. These are all, I mean, really... Such a way you
I mean, one by one, I mean, final trial and Bhulabhai Desai. These are all, I mean, another thing is 23rd, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Sir, we, Netaji Subhash Chandra 23rd is his...
Yes, 23rd.
That is also keeping in mind we arranged this actually. So that, I mean, after 23rd, then it's a late, too late, so that the, before that, will be everyone will... Please you take this and you will pass on to that so that we'll happy. You think it meanwhile anyone? I mean you ask any relevant
question. Actually on Netaji's birthday we should rename the Andaman and Nicobar as Swadhin and Swaraj.
Yes.
That is the name which he had given.
Yes.
So it should be done. We should make a representation to the government that it should be done.
Yeah, sir.
You give it to sir. You give it to sir. Give your opinion, sir.
I entirely agree. Because he had very thoughtfully named them Swaraj and
some other name?
Shaheed and Swaraj.
Swadhin.
Swaraj, the Andaman was called Swaraj and the other was Shaheed Island. I'll again check up because...
Please.
No. Whatever you have said is
One minute. You can say, take it. Amit, give it to him.
Whatever you have read right now, it was Swaraj and Shaheed. Yeah.
Shaheed.
It was there.
You are right.
Shaheed.
He may be right also, but
no.
I'm not sure about this. You are also a criminal.
There is an island called Shaheed.
Give it to him. Amit.
There is an island called Shaheed.
Put you on this thing, Amit.
No, literally it sounds good because the. Swaraj is all right, but the Shaheed also because so many detainees were kept there and they died also.
So in memory of them it could be. Netaji himself went
yes.
to Sedu Sahib.
Overall, you are feeling it.
No, today's lecture I found is very impressive, very good. None of them is dissatisfied, none of them has any questions,
which is a great achievement for a speaker.
One second.
This gives me a little thought. I want to request Mr. Sheshagiri Rao to have, you know, some lectures, a series of lectures based on what I may call our legal legacy. Because there is a lot of things, you know. What is legacy? Legacy is when there is something transformational thing happening in which people participate, that is judges and who deliver judgment and also lawyers. Who make preparations and argue cases. This is our legacy. So I would suggest, and there, it occurs to me that, you know, as I understand, as I was able to recall, Mr. Setubad, Mr. Daftari, Mr. Vishwanath Shastri, I think
his
portrait is there.
Last photograph.
I have some little experience with Mr. Shastri, who was such a great lawyer. He was very, I would say he was very oblivious to his dress and all these things. I remember one thing, one incident happened. He was called suddenly with all the briefs carrying, you know, because he did not have all those chopdars and other stuff. He was doing everything himself, very modest man. He suddenly rushed in court in which one of the judges, Justice Kapoor, told him, Mr. Shastri, mind your bands. Because they got disabled. He said, never mind the bands, my lord, come to the point. The point is...
you take a view
so
and...
Particular yes, and there were judges. Point. Judges like K.K. Matthew, at least I know, and Chinnappa Reddy, who were so modest on elect. On the airports, you could see them, you know, in ordinary clothes and chappals. And if you have missed them, then they would come up to you and say, sir, where are you going and all?
You want one? Yeah, one. Please.
So this is a question that I have as a youngster that I've heard from my professors. With respect to how criminal cases are held and how criminal trials are conducted. Earlier it was termed as rather the craft of the lawyer in the manner in which he presents his case and so on. But now this was a remark that I heard from one of the professors who said, now criminal trials don't happen in courts, it happens in the police station. And it's all about how the lawyer's skill in the police station. So, I mean, how far is this true? This is as a youngster that I'm asking, so...
Yeah.
I have no experience, but it should happen.
How far would this be true?
In the court, not in the police station. You have to show your skill in the court.
Not true, but how? What is your take on this? I mean, how do you see
this? I'm shocked.
Has
that
it,
you know, skill in the police station, which you can imagine what it is. Skill has to be shown in the court. As lawyers, we should show our skill in the court, not the police stations.
Please, this one thing.
Okay, give it.
Just adjacent to Red Fort is the Salimgar Fort.
Salimgar Fort.
And it is connected to Red Fort.
Yes.
So there, all the detainees, they were housed there. Yeah. So even now, there are the cottages are there where Shahnawaz Khan and Dhillon and they were, and Sehgal, they were housed.
Yeah, now we'll. Thank you. Shaheed and Swaraj. Shaheed and Swaraj. Shaheed and Saman. Thank you very much, friend. Very patiently, you heard very. One of the experiment today. I don't know. Let us see how future it will go. Our making all these things. I hope. I mean, can kindly join for a cup of tea. Can extend our. I mean, I'll not to hesitate. Kindly, sir, you also. Thank you very much, sir. Nachappan sir is here. He is ISIL Krishnaminan Bhavan Chief, Indian Society of International Law. Former MP also. He defeated Chidambaram also from Shivaganga.
Therefore, Justice Rao has given the nickname Giant Killer.
He is a senior advocate now.
Okay.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. Your presence, I mean. Sir, once again, thank you very much for you. It's a really, it's a rich experience, sir. Yeah, definitely in life.